Brock, you have a preference?
No.
Yeah, trying to be close to exit.
Does Ian want to be here close to the screen? You want to be here?
Ian has one choice. And the music's, then the music stops. Good, everybody ready? Morning, everybody. Thank you for coming here this morning, for spending your time with us. I want to introduce a few people here before we get started. Ian Shaw is to my immediate right. Dr. Brock Wright, head of Shared Health Services, is with us to our left. And of course, to my far left is Karen Hurd, our tremendous deputy for health. Want to speak a bit more about health transformation today and the plans that we have going forward. As you know, more than 2 years ago now, our government was elected on a number of different platforms, but certainly one of them was to improve health care in Manitoba. That means to build a system that is more focused on patients, so one that is easier to access for those who are within the system, one where services are consistent and equally as important, one where those who are working in the system find that it's the kind of system where they can deliver the services that they are trained to and that they want to provide. Manitoba, as many of you know, has been among the highest spenders per capita when it comes to healthcare in Canada for many years, and yet many of the key indicators when it comes to performance in the healthcare system have indicated we are not where we should be for that level of investment in healthcare. We have a province of about 1.2 million people, and while it's fairly large geographically, it is still relatively small compared to other provinces when it comes to population. That should give us an advantage in terms of being able to have a system that is more cohesive, one that is able to plan provincially but deliver healthcare services locally. That hasn't always been the case. We have a complex system. Many of the studies that we've undertaken have shown how complex that system is and the difficulty that people have traversing the system and trying to get the services that they like. So we knew that we couldn't keep doing the same thing over and over again, and that money wasn't a simple solution to the problems in healthcare, as it's proven not to be in many other places in Canada. So as you know, we've undertaken significant transformation in the healthcare system. You've heard about many of those changes already, of course, and reported on them extensively. Those changes have been based on experts' advice, and we remain committed to the changes. We're already seeing, we believe, to be positive results within the healthcare system, and we believe that we'll continue to see more positive results. We are here to tell you today about more of the roadmap as we move forward with transformation in developing a clinical and services plan that will identify gaps that exist within the healthcare system, ensure that we establish standards and create models of service delivery that are consistent within the province of Manitoba. We will talk about the realigning and the shrinking of the administrative and support functions for certain organizations to allow us to reinvest those efficiencies within the front lines of healthcare. And of course, this is about ensuring that care is delivered in a better way, in a more effective way. But when you do that, you do find efficiencies, and that is not something that I would apologize for, because as the Minister of Health, I have a responsibility to ensure that health care is delivered today, but I also have a responsibility to ensure that health care is sustainable to be able to be delivered tomorrow for your kids, for mine, and for our grandkids. And so that is an important commitment that we've made to Manitobans. Before I turn it over to Ian Shaw, who's our transformation management leader, to to give you some more of the details, I want to reiterate something I've said in the past, and I think I've said whether it's reported or not, I want you to know it. I have great confidence in the leadership teams that we have within the Department of Health, within our regions, within shared health, and throughout the system. I've been incredibly impressed with their dedication to the transformation, and not only their willingness to take it on, but to take it on in a way that is energetic and enthusiastic. And that, of course, is important because the leadership sets the tone through the system. And I know in talking to frontline workers, while there's been some disruption, some difficult times when it comes to changes, because change is often difficult, they too have really taken on the transformation in the healthcare system in a way that deserves tremendous credit, because they are on the front lines of care and making a difference every day. So throughout the entire healthcare system, from the leadership that is represented with me here today and beyond that, through to the front lines, just tremendously proud of the people who are working in the healthcare system and the energy and the enthusiasm which they've taken on the transformation. So with that, Mr. Shaw will take us through some more detailed presentations.
Good afternoon. I would like to start today by giving you some insight into the process of developing the blueprint and the roadmap for the transformation, and by the end, hopefully, you'll have a sense of the scope of the transformation, the series of projects that we have planned over the next bit of time, and a bit of the reasons why it's important for this transformation to take forward. So next. The blueprinting process itself started off from a very straightforward idea of understanding what all the system does. And so next, so the first step was actually to understand from a level of each detailed function what all of the RHAs, Addictions Foundation Manitoba, Cancer Care, and Diagnostic Services Manitoba did. And once we understood those functions, next, we were able to normalize them to make sure that we had a standard understanding of what those functions were, and working from some principles that we've established for the transformation, basically from a blank piece of paper, redefine what the system should look like from a high-performing system perspective. And that included the description of what the role of the department should be going forward, as well as the new organization, Shared Health, and the role of the service delivery organizations. Next. You could come up with lots of designs that might work. One of the things that we wanted to do to make sure that this transformation was on a solid footprint was to combine that modeling process with some financial analysis. Detailed model, a financial model of the entire healthcare system was developed, and that included all the position data across all the entities in the system. Next, and that allowed us to be able to produce scenarios to test the blueprint to make sure that it achieved the intended outcomes, the synergy and scale. And next, and then that was in turn help us to develop and identify projects that could be sequenced for the overall implementation as part of the roadmap. Next. The system itself, this is a balanced scorecard. I think most people are familiar with this structure. You have the customer normally on the top, but we have it on the left of the healthcare system that came from the blueprinting process. Most of us are familiar with the left-hand side. We're all customers of the system. There's 1.3 million of us. Manitoba has a very unique geographic circumstance with a large urban area and then a relatively small population dispersed over a very large area, and I think people really have their head around that. What they don't understand as much is the right-hand side of this diagram. With 55,400 employees in the healthcare system, that would make our healthcare system about the 10th largest organization in Canada, about the same size as Bell, more or less 10,000 employees more than Bank of Montreal or CIBC, and 15,000 more employees than Power Corporation, the company that owns Great-West Life. At $6.2 billion worth of expenditure, we'd be about the 100th biggest company in Canada. I'd be the same size as Rogers, bigger than CN or CP. I'm a rural boy, and that actually shocks me every time I say it. And one of the things that we wanted to point out here was the complexity of the system. And the simplest example on here is the stat here that talks about 250 service purchase agreements. Money flows from the department to RHAs, who in turn contract with hospitals or personal care homes through a network of service purchase agreements. Over time, those agreements have become very non-standard individual agreements, all with different expectations of the organizations in terms of what they report to government, how they work, what service they're expected to deliver. Being someone that's been outside of the system and engaged in this process, it's actually almost hard to believe that we even have a healthcare system, because right from that very fundamental level, we're really funding a bunch of individual organizations and trying to integrate them ad hocly. Next. From a health expenditure point of view, next. These are slides from the KPMG report, and you see the cost curve for Ontario and BC, next, and Manitoba on a cost per capita basis. Manitoba's healthcare expenditures have been growing at 5.8% per year. If you use your rule of 72, that means our $6.2 billion of expenditure will grow to about $13 billion in 12 years. Over the same period of time, our population will grow from 1.2 million to about 1.5 million people. That's a sustainable cost, or an unsustainable cost curve. And it is something that, from a citizen point of view working on this project, I think about my kids very often. Next. And that might be okay if we actually got the outcomes from that level of expenditure that you might expect from spending more money. And next. What the reality is, next, that for many of the kinds of things that most citizens want, we still have performance outcomes that put us near the bottom of our peers across Manitoba in terms of wait lists and key and priority procedures. Next. There are some clear patterns KPMG identified in terms of the expenditure where Manitoba is different from other jurisdictions. Next. In particular, we have a very acute and institutional-based hospital oriented system. We pay, and in that system, we pay about 1.3 times our peers. And then similarly, with respect to capital, public health, and administrative costs, our expenditure and compared to other jurisdictions is about 1.3 times. And so there's some very clear areas that we could target in the transformation using this information. Next. This is a picture from the recently released Virgo report that shows the organizational view of access to care by an organization for mental health and addictions. It just helps you understand the level of complexity that if you're a patient trying to navigate between the various service providers, and in this case, with departments outside the health department. And another way, next, the animation that I'm about to show you starts to show you points of presence or points of service in our network. So here you have First Nations health services delivery locations, next, primary care service locations, next. Emergency departments and EMS stations, next. Mental health and addiction services, points of presence, next. And here's the composite. The point of the animation has helped you see that really we don't have a situation where we have a problem with access to services. What Manitoba has a problem with is integration of services. And most of us know, and on our day-to-day basis, the issue is about how to migrate yourself through the system and between the points of care. And this graphic really underscores that point. Next. For the first time, next, through this blueprinting process, we were able to then take the functional analysis, next, and be able to identify clearly from a functional point of view how the entire system was configured. And so the point here on the left, you have Diagnostic Services Manitoba, Cancer Care, Addictions Foundation in the middle, the four rural regional health authorities on the right, the WHA. We were able to see in absolute detail how the whole system worked top to bottom and where the level of overlap, the competency and capability of the various entities existed, and where there was opportunities to find alignment and simplification, and where there was opportunities to make streamlining and to improve performance and service delivery to patients. Next. So to summarize that point, the transformation is really trying to focus on the perspective that we have a highly complex system that has limited integration and really has an acute institutional-oriented perspective that in many ways sees fewer patients and does that at a higher cost of delivery. And we don't, in the end, have much evidence that we get better care or better performance compared to our peers. Next. The transformation itself gets at that by some clear principles that were agreed to with the Transformation Leadership Team, which is a group of 15 individuals across the healthcare system and government that focused on that core problem of effectiveness, overlap of functionality, trying to get to simplification of the overall system and improve the accountability of the organizations in delivering frontline care to Manitobans. Next. To skip ahead, I'm a consultant and I like to count things. If you look in the current state, that picture that I just showed you has about 12 organizations and 9 boards, There's been a lot of discussion over the number of bargaining units that Manitoba has. There's the 250 service purchase agreements, and at the end of this transformation, if we skip ahead, there's significant opportunity to improve the system by consolidating some of the organizations and boards. And the collective bargaining process will reduce the complexity of the bargaining units, and we think that there's a significant opportunity to improve that commissioning model and the framework of agreements. One area that will create significant benefits from a cost-saving perspective is the introduction of some provincial shared services that have been done in other jurisdictions as a way to lower administrative and management costs and be able to redirect that investment back into the overall healthcare system. And in turn, that will see changes to some of the key provider facilities being operated at a provincial level. Next. And this means a lot from a patient perspective. Our current environment is really based on points of care with limited integration, and through the clinical and preventive services planning initiative that Dr. Wright will talk about in a minute, we really believe that we'll have an opportunity to define clear patient-centered pathways. If you're a rural person, from a rural area to urban, back to your home site, or from a primary care point of location to specialty care and back to your community, and that will really have us in a position from a government's perspective to be able to make decisions on care and allocate resources in a way that really have improvements to Manitobans. Next. The concept of the transformation is very simple, and so we've made a conceptual diagram here to help you get your head around the key moves, and then we'll show you the balance of that in a minute. On the top, you see the RHAs and on the left, the department with Selkirk Mental Health Center and Chatham Lab, Diagnostic Services Manitoba, Cancer Care Addictions Foundation, and so on. The first phase of the transformation is relatively straightforward. Next. And that's to establish Shared Health. And on April 3rd, Diagnostic Services Manitoba was renamed Shared Health Manitoba and has taken over responsibility for the clinical and preventive services planning delivery of the work. Next. The first step in the transformation will be to take out the common shared services that can be delivered at a provincial scale and introduce them into Shared Health. Those would be things like on the health support side, laundry and food services, or on the administrative services side, payroll and benefits, supply chain, or other functions like that. And there are many jurisdictions around the world have taken steps to implement this kind of shared services function in their healthcare system. Next. Step two then is to take the core programs and facilities that can deliver services at a provincial scale and bring them into Shared Health. And these decisions have all not been confirmed, but to give you a sense, this would mean, consistent with the Virgo report, that facilities like operations like the Addictions Foundations of Manitoba or Selkirk Mental Health Center, together with Chatham Provincial Lab, can be consolidated into Shared Health and operated at a provincial scale. Next. And then in the last phase of the transformation, next, would really be about strengthening the role of the department as a manager, or what we talk about as being a commissioner and a manager of accountability across the system. Next. And this is one of the key things that we learned from the blueprinting process, is that the role of the department had actually wandered away from the capabilities of departments in most other jurisdictions, and its ability to actually manage effectively the delivery of care had been diffused out to various organizations. And so really what we're talking about here is bringing back the ability of the department and strengthen its role to be able to manage the performance and accountability of all the delivery organizations. And in the end, we're left with a system that has been right-sized, normalized, modernized, the minister likes me to talk about often. And you see here that the Winnipeg Regional Health Authority's role is aligned to be similar as a service delivery organization with the other RHAs, and that Shared Health's role is introduced as a support to those RHAs to deliver core clinical preventive planning services together with those administrative shared services in support of a strengthened department. That's what the transformation is all about. Next. And we've been able to take this and reduce it into the blueprint. If you compare this picture to the previous one, you can see certainly there's still a lot of boxes, but the point is that we now have a much more standardized way of delivering the functions, and that we've actually gotten away from the perspective of 250 organizations things doing independently to one system working in an integrated way. Next. This has been translated into a series of implementation projects. This is what we call the roadmap. The roadmap has seven work streams. The seventh one we don't show you here. It's the project management work stream. So it has all the things about getting project managers and so on in place. But the key work streams are about reorganizing the department and refocusing its role as a commissioner. All the service delivery transformation moves, including moving Health Sciences Center from the Winnipeg Regional Health Authority to Shared Health as Manitoba's provincial hospital on April 1st, 2019, and as well as implementing other services like EMS and patient transport. We have the stream around developing the clinical and preventive services plan, implementing shared services, changes around the workforce, and the overall some area where some additional strategy work needs to be developed to deliver the government's perspective on things like engagement with Indigenous communities or implementation of mental health and addictions. Next. The roadmap's going to be implemented in three phases or waves, and those phases really are planned loosely over a 12 to 15 month period with different time frames for each initiative. To give you a sense of what wave one will look like, which is the most well-defined. This kind of program, you don't actually have the details of every wave locked down, and they evolve as you move forward. But wave one will really be about establishing shared health, which has already happened, and getting that redefined role of all the various organizations with a specific emphasis on improving the accountability and performance capability of the various organizations. I think the media, you're very well aware of the steps that have been taken on bargaining unit restructuring, and that process is underway. The commissioner has been proclaimed, and work is underway with the various union groups to move that process forward. Five key shared services have been decided to be implemented already in shared health, and they're identified here. The first one is EMS and patient transport. Transportation service, so bringing the management and delivery of the EMS and patient transport services into shared health in an integrated fashion across all communities. Similarly for diagnostics, which consists of laboratory and imaging services, so bringing them together and really fulfilling the role that Diagnostic Services Manitoba was set out to achieve initially. And then three administrative shared services, one for human resources, one for supply chain, and one for ICT management. And then there are a number of clinical changes that will be aligned with the transformation. The WHA Phase 2 consolidation changes have already been announced, and so we reference them here. The two projects are integrated, and there will be some recommendations from Shared Health to Government in the next month or so around repositioning some of the existing rural facilities and aligning that with some changes to some EMS emergency services protocols over the next while. Next. Phase two, we'll see continued work on the labor front with negotiations after the collective bargaining restructuring process. And this would be the phase when the department takes steps to divest itself of some of its frontline service delivery functions. The two major ones in that would be the potential movement of Selkirk Mental Health Center and CADM Lab to Shared Health. There's a detailed business case and planning work that needs to be done to confirm that decision, but if that is decided, a Shared Health would be the destination. And then you see the introduction of some additional shared services for laundry, food, medical device reprocessing, which is actually the cleaning and preparation of equipment that you use in medical procedures, and then for drug procurement and reprocess from distribution. There will be additional changes we anticipate coming from the clinical and preventive services planning process. Subsequent changes for reconfiguration of the system, and the idea of the transformation was to give that clinical preventive services planning process time to be able to implement that. Next. And then from on a wave three basis, the idea could continue. At this time, we believe that the department's capability to have a new and completely strengthened commissioning and accountability model will be in place, and that will change the current environment where most organizations are funded in a block or one lump sum of dollars to a combination of block funding and performance-based contracting for services. And there may be additional shared services or changes, but we just don't know yet what the clinical preventive services plan will drive forward. And as that comes to being in the next year, we'll have a better sense of that. Next. From a clinical and preventive services plan perspective, we wanted to make sure that people were aware that this work is part of the transformation. 12 clinical teams have been formed to cover various areas of clinical delivery, from mental health and addiction to primary health care. The significance of the colors here are that some of those, the four purple colors are sort of key intense drivers of change. We have some condition-based in the light blue treatment areas, and then in light green, these are the areas that really sort of drive primary demand in the system. The clinical and preventive services plan is going to be completed within a year's time frame, and this would be the first time that Manitoba has ever had an integrated clinical preventive services plan for the province. Next. And one of the key features of this is that Brock and Lynette Siragusa are implementing that, is to put in place a very integrated and robust team that requires in the governance that there is a rural, at least one rural leader of each of the clinical teams, together with a specialist provider from that has a common role with shared health and the University of Manitoba, together with individuals representing nursing, allied health, community service delivery, and Indigenous and others, so that we have a very strong basis to align the work of practitioners and get support and commitment to the clinical preventive services plan as it's being developed. Next. And then, as the minister said, all of this also does have a financial aspect to it. The way we've done this in the transformation has really been to look at how do we improve the system first from its performance, and then see where that gets us from a outcomes perspective financially. Next. And we know that from the changes to the department in orange, the restructuring of the balance of the other services, and then the implementation in yellow, and then the implementation of shared services in green, that as they're fully rolled out and the benefits come to place, that will result in a savings to the system of $64 million or so on an annual basis. Next. And then, as identified in the KPMG report and some other work that we validated, that as the clinical preventive services plan is implemented, there's a significant opportunity to lower the cost of healthcare delivery while improving its benefit. And you see the cone of potential from the clinical preventive side here. And so the transformation really initially will focus on making changes, not in frontline care, but in administrative and support services, to be able to basically get us to the point that the changes that are critical from the clinical and preventive services planning work can kick in and move the whole transformation forward. Next. So in summary, the health transformation really is a combination of two things. It's about addressing the need for improved quality of care and sustainability of the system at the same time. I think about this loss and I feel about this very passionately as a Manitoban. We pay too much for the health care that we get, and we do not see the outcomes that other jurisdictions do. Part of this, and a significant part of the fact, is that we have a very complex jurisdiction for our size, and that complexity impacts care first and creates an increase in cost. The clinical the transformation itself will address that by implementing an integrated clinical and preventive services plan that will have clear pathways to care and consistent standards, and that will be used to help us improve the organizational accountability of the organizations within the system, and use the opportunity that creates to make targeted investments back in areas of care that Manitobans require in terms of mental health and addictions or community or other areas. So with that, I'd like to turn over to Deputy Minister Karen Hurd.
Good afternoon, everyone. Karen Hurd, Deputy Minister of Manitoba Health, Seniors and Active Living. The transformation program was established to guide a thoughtful planning and phased implementation of broad health system changes. The people in our health system provide excellent care, but over the past few years, opportunities to perform better have been highlighted in several expert studies. Organizations in our system are, above all else, responsible for delivering excellent services to Manitobans. We know that there are areas for improvement, but we have struggled as a system to improve wait times or extend services that should be available as close to home as possible in a consistent and safe manner in ways that best meet the needs of Manitobans. The opportunities to do things differently and better requires us to align our priorities and focus and identify areas for investment and areas where efficiencies may be realized. And it requires a thorough understanding of where the system works well and places where it needs to improve. Our planning processes that you've seen here today have involved extensive consultations with stakeholders from Manitoba's health system. The transformation leadership team is using data, leading practices and experience from other jurisdictions, the expertise of Manitoba's own clinician experts, and broad stakeholder engagement, as well as several reports over the recent past about our health system in Manitoba. This allows us to prioritize the areas that we plan to improve upon, and these efforts have resulted in the blueprint we are releasing today. This is a plan that was unanimously supported by the health system leaders who form the Transformation Leadership Team. A better health system is one that meets the needs of our population. It is simple in structure and it is easy to access in a timely manner. A more streamlined system ensures stability and allows for continued investment in priority healthcare services for Manitobans rather than supporting inefficient or ineffective administrative structures. It allows us to use our resources to support staff who deliver excellent patient care using modern equipment and innovative technology. It requires a process to report and measure achievements. It requires each organization to focus on its own core role and mandate and be accountable for excellent service delivery to Manitobans. As part of this work, the role of the department itself will change. In the target state, the role of the health department will focus on policy, planning, funding, and oversight of the health system. As Ian mentioned, our role will no longer include direct service delivery. And as he mentioned, some of that means that direct operations will be leaving the health department and moving to the health system. So areas like Selkirk Mental Health Center, Caddam Provincial Lab. While these areas will continue to provide excellent services for the people of our province, they will work more closely with the regional health authorities and other service delivery organizations in our province. These department changes will strengthen the department's focus on overseeing and setting policy and funding practices, which will improve how our provincial system is run. It will reduce overlap between the work of the department and regional health authorities and other organizations, and it will help us ensure appropriate oversight and accountability of the provincial health system as a whole. In some limited cases, specific resources from the regional health authorities and health organizations will be realigned within the department. Examples of that include resources associated with information management and analytics, performance and accountability management, and provincial service integration and policy. Manitoba Health Seniors and Active Living will focus on modernizing how it funds regional health authorities and other health service organizations so that we ensure that Manitobans are getting timely access to the services they require. This is sometimes called commissioning. We intend to improve our funding approaches to commission services that best meet the needs of Manitobans. Our province has great healthcare staff, it has great organizations and really good working relationships between organizations already. Sometimes our structural challenges have not allowed us to operate at that full potential, and the plan that we are releasing today will help us collectively meet that potential. It's an honor to work with so many others in our health system who are committed to move these improvements forward so that all Manitobans benefit from more responsive and sustainable services. And I'll turn it over to Dr. Brock Wright from Shared Health.
Thanks very much. A lot has already been covered that I won't repeat, but I'll just make a few points. First of all, you know, since the minister announced Shared Health and the transformation of the health system a year ago, my colleagues and I have had the privilege of meeting with many different groups across the province. And what has really stood out is that everyone we have met, without exception, has embraced the central tenet of this transformation, which is that if we're to improve access to care, improve quality of care, and make the system more sustainable, then we must come together across the province and function as a truly provincial healthcare system. To the minister's points earlier, people do understand as well that we need to find more efficient ways of providing health services so that resources can be redeployed to areas of real need, such as Ian mentioned, mental health and addictions, Indigenous health, hip and knee surgery, cataract surgery, and many other areas. Today's announcement really does send a powerful message that our health system is now aligned in terms of where we need to go and how we will work together to get there. I do want to thank the minister and his government for giving our health system this opportunity. There have been many studies in the past, as Karen alluded to, with many excellent recommendations that were not implemented. And that was because we have been a very complex health system and we struggle to respond to those kind of recommendations. The consolidation of services currently underway in Winnipeg was first recommended more than 20 years ago. Creating a provincially managed EMS system, as we're planning to do now, was actually recommended back in, I think it was 2013. And there have been countless other recommendations from groups like the Provincial Medical Leadership Council and others that were never acted upon. But now we have the opportunity to address those structural impediments and come together across the province to align our efforts. Now we will be rowing in the same direction towards a better health system for all Manitobans. We really, as Ian was saying, we've really never had an opportunity like this to work together within the province. I've been in the system quite a while. I started as a medical student in 1980, and I can tell you that we have never had this kind of ability to work together across the system towards a common purpose. RHAs, cancer care, and others in our system will still be responsible for planning clinical services and setting standards, but the difference is they will no longer be doing so independently. Through shared health, stakeholders will work together as partners to plan services and set standards, and we will do so in a transparent manner that's focused on the health needs of the population, with input from patients and families and their communities. Organizations will still be responsible individually for day-to-day operations and will be accountable to those in their respective regions, but even there, organizations will be better able to support each other in ways that were not possible before, because we will all be aligned towards achieving a common vision and common goals. As it is often said, change, and I think the minister spoke to the change aspect, change, even positive change, is difficult. And while we are all very excited about the many opportunities to improve the health system, we are cognizant of the need to do everything we can to support our staff and those we serve as these changes are introduced. And just a personal note, what's been most encouraging for me, what's been most encouraging certainly in the past year, and what has certainly exceeded my expectations, is how well the various parts of the health system have come together to support this effort, and more specifically to support this blueprint. And you may be interested to know that other provinces are increasingly interested in what is happening in Manitoba, as they struggle with many similar challenges. And the positive feedback we've received from a number of other provinces provides further assurance that we are indeed on the right track. So thank you very much.
Well, I look forward to seeing how you're going to write this in 500 words or less, but or clip it in 30 seconds or less. But are there questions that you have?
You're going to save about $64 million through this, which is a pretty small amount of money considering the health budget is somewhere around $6 billion, so you're talking about maybe 1%. You've also said that we have one of the highest per capita, one of the most expensive healthcare systems in Canada. You're not really saving a lot. $64 million is a fairly small amount. Are we still going to be one of the higher cost healthcare systems in Canada once this is all said and done?
Well, there's no question, Tom, that the primary objective of the variety of reports, whether it was Dr. Peachy's report or the Virgo report, wasn't about saving money. It was about building a system that was more effective. The result of that is saving money, and that's has been identified. But the impetus for the change on phase one and now phase two on consolidation and what's going forward on the blueprint isn't just about saving money. It's a bit of a byproduct, a happy byproduct, but nonetheless a byproduct. But we are not only able to save money, but I think also slow the rate of growth in terms of how quickly the system was growing in terms of the amount of money that was being put into it. So there's savings that are involved, but there's also the slowing of the growth that was happening, which, you know, I sometimes use the example, it's maybe oversimplified, but if we'd continue to go at the rate of growth that we were headed in, it wouldn't be that long before there'd be two departments in government, the department that spent all the money, health, and the department that brought the money in, finance. That is the trajectory that we were headed in. So it's both about saving money from an efficiency perspective when you better the system, but it's also about slowing the rate of growth. Ian, do you want to add to that?
Yeah, and I think the numbers that we showed were trying to be conservative in this. And so those costs, the $64 million in particular, were really only restructuring costs. So one of those shared services was supply chain, for example. We didn't overpromise that we're going to deliver, but there will be savings within the supply chain itself, within the HR area as we start to deliver the workforce. We're not projecting those ahead because that's going to materialize over time. So I think what we're showing you is the base case, not the aggressive one.
How much more do you think you might save? Do you have any projections on that? I
mean, KPMG, I would point you there. You can go and quickly find, like, there is many opportunities in all of the areas of the healthcare system. Yeah.
And here today, yeah. I mean, you're saying there's a $64 million saving potential, but you're also telling me that that's just some of the base case projections, that there's other saving opportunities. How much more are we talking about? A few million? $100 million?
Well, what we showed there on the clinical side, together with those combined ones, gets into the $200 million per year.
Range. So you could be saving upwards of $200 million a year fully implemented.
That's
the
clinical changes in this 5-year plan, or
are
you talking about everything else you're doing as well?
I just wanted to get an answer. Is that something that?
You know, I think Ian was saying it's small C conservative.
Small C
conservative. In terms of the estimates. You know, what they baselined is the $65 million. I think that there are more savings than that. The plan isn't driven specifically by savings. This plan is driven by having a better system, but there will be more savings.
I think you kept emphasizing that we have one of the most expensive. I want to know, it's going to be paying a lot compared to other provinces.
But also,
obviously the goal is to get better quality and better outcomes, but are we going to still be paying, you know, among the highest when compared to other provinces?
But what also drives that is the rate of growth, and I think that we've shown that we can slow the rate of growth within the healthcare system over the last 2 years. We've, you know, been funding at, you know, both the rate of inflation, still record level of investment, but certainly we've gone from you know, levels of 6-7% to significantly less than that, and the system's been able to balance within that. There are many people, maybe some within this room, who didn't believe that was possible. Winnipeg Regional Health Authority is expecting to deliver a balanced budget. Other regions are delivering on the mandate that they've been provided to balance their budget. So it's savings from the changes, for sure, but also the rate of growth, I think, which will change.
Can you not save, though, and I know this is not about savings, but and I think, Deputy Minister, you could speak to this, is that, for example, on northern transportation and on procurement, for example, you look at your proactive disclosure website and you see the hundreds of thousands and the millions of dollars you spend every month on northern transportation. Could you not, as part of procurement, carve that up into a handful of contracts to people and realize hundreds of thousands of dollars of savings, if not millions, in that alone?
No question. I think part of that's also working together with the federal government. I think we've had some initial high-level discussions about working together on transportation because we're transporting Manitobans, but the cost is coming from one taxpayer. And I think there's ways we could work together with the federal government to reduce those transportation costs. But also there's a lot of things in terms of not transporting people. And so technology the PCOS plan, which would have doctors available, emergency room doctors to speak on a through technology to ensure that people who don't need to be transported down aren't being transported is part of the planning that's happening, and we're having further discussions at the end of June with other health ministers about how we can better utilize technology to prevent people from being transported. So you're right, Richard, but it's two-pronged. It's how do we better align ourselves when we're transporting people who need to be transported, but how do we also ensure that those who don't need to be transported aren't transported?
So Karen? Well,
I was just going to say one of the reasons why the EMS work stream is prioritized early on is because we have tried to prioritize the areas where we think the greatest amount of savings would be early on.
So can we get into the how and the what, the numbers here? So we're the 10th largest employer in the country. How many people are going to lose their job in the first couple of years? Or are the savings going to come from procurement? But clearly there has to be reasons
So the commitment that we made and continue to hold to is that nurses who are working within Winnipeg, those who want to continue to work within the healthcare system will have the opportunity to do so. Will there be realignment of others within the workforce? I'm sure that there will be. That will probably mean, you know, maybe different models of care or people who maybe have different scope of service. I mean, I think one of the things that Shared Health is committed to do, and this is important, is to look at the different scope of practice that different professions have and how does that align with other provinces. Can we better utilize scope of practice? So ultimately, patients will get the care that they need. You know, are there different providers who can provide that care? I think we need to look at that. Because, you know, healthcare, while it's a significant economic driver, it's not my mandate to build the economy through economic development of healthcare. My mandate is to deliver healthcare in the best way that it can be delivered. So that requires looking at scope of practice and changing that's possible. The commitment that we made, though, and that we've held to and delivered on, is that those nurses who are working within Winnipeg, if they want to have a job within the system, may not be in the same place in the system, but they would have that opportunity.
I've got to declutter your answer there, because
declutter. I thought that was pretty clear, Sean.
No, sir. Nobody's going to understand different models of care or scope of service. They need to know they're going to be.
Well, I can give you an example if you'd like. One of those examples might be paramedics. I think paramedics have often talked about being able to provide more service, particularly in rural Manitoba, in terms of expanding their scope of practice, and could they provide more immediate care within rural communities that are otherwise underserviced? I think that would be an example. We've, of course, moved them to self-regulation. That might help them in terms of some of that determination. But those are the sort of things. So, you know, LPNs, what type of extended work could they do? Those are the sort of scope of practice we need to look at, and haven't really done a good job, I think, of looking at the variety of people who provide service within the system and seeing if their practice could be better utilized to help more people within the system.
So just building on Sean's point, my apologies, just building on this, is that ultimately, and you look at that map of all the facilities that you have in rural Manitoba that overlap, you've said, Minister, consistently, get transportation under control, have that plan, and then we'll have the conversation about what facilities remain open, which ones close, which new ones we have to build. Where are we in that conversation?
So I'm not sure if that's the elephant in the room that you're referring to that we're now going to slay.
Because this is a very complex plan.
It is.
But people want to know their local health care, what's going to change? That's the elephant that you're all dealing with in government.
Sure.
Because this stuff is inside baseball. The rest of the stuff is the actual.
Well, it's complex. I mean, inside baseball, to an extent, I'd agree with you. But, I mean, I think that and the media has sometimes rightfully said, well, we'd like to see more details in terms of the plan. So you're seeing more details in terms of the plan today. So is it inside baseball? I think that there's been a lot of people who've been asking for it, and so they're seeing it. In terms of rural Manitoba, and having lived in rural Manitoba my entire life, I'm particularly aware of some of the challenges within rural Manitoba. We've asked Shared Health to bring forward recommendations for us in the by June or July. You can look at the calendar as well as I can to know that we're in June, so I'm expecting those recommendations relatively soon. I haven't received them yet. And will there be changes in rural Manitoba? I'm sure that they will be. They won't be driven by costs. They'll be driven by, you know, what is the best service provision. We have a lot of emergency rooms in rural Manitoba where you're not getting emergency services. And that can be not only disingenuous, but that can be dangerous at times. I mean, you might have people who are presenting at something that says it's an emergency room expecting a certain level of service because of what they're presenting with, and they're not able to get it there because they haven't been able to get it there for years. And so that's part of what I think Shared Health is undertaking to, and I think is near completion of that work, to determine what services are actually being delivered in these facilities. And what can we actually commit to providing in those services? How can we better them, either in the region or in those facilities? So I expect to get that within the next, I said June or July. So that's, I think Dr. Wright has rarely let me down, never let me down, sorry, not rarely. And I'm sure he'll deliver those recommendations on time. Well, listen, I mean, every decision we make has...
It's one thing to have recommendations. Is the other thing to actually go out and be brave and stand up and say, we're going to close these facilities down.
So if we haven't, as a government, haven't demonstrated some extent of bravery when it comes to healthcare, I don't know what more you need to demonstrate that, Richard. If I would have told you 2 years ago that we were going to undertake a transformation that would consolidate three emergency rooms within Winnipeg, that would look to repurpose quick care clinics, that would look to change structurally how the system works in Winnipeg and beyond, you probably wouldn't have believed me. Or maybe you would have given me more credit than you would have. But I think that we've demonstrated more courage when it comes to healthcare than any government in Canada, and I'm not patting myself on the back for that. Those who are around me are the ones who are really implementing that change. But this is a government that's taken bold steps on healthcare because, as Dr. Wright has said, bold steps haven't been taken for 20 years. And I'm not trying to make that as a political statement. That's just the reality. Because every time you make changes in healthcare, it is difficult and it is emotional for people. And I heard all of the stories before phase one about ambulances getting stuck on Pembina Highway and people being left outside of doors. That didn't transpire. We planned the system and the changes well. That doesn't mean everything goes perfectly, and it means you react when things don't go perfectly. But we've taken bold steps to better the system, and that'll be the same process we take for rural Manitoba. Will some of the changes be difficult? Of course, because every change in healthcare is difficult. But they'll be driven by evidence. They'll be driven with the motivation to better healthcare. If we haven't proven as a government that we're willing to take courageous steps in healthcare, boy, Richard, I don't know what else I can do for you.
How many fewer jobs will there be after all these changes are done?
And we don't have. Not in a position to give you those. I mean, a lot of the transformation has to happen in terms of negotiations and discussions. So we don't have that number for you.
Well, can you give us some examples of it? You want to have 64 million?
Sorry, this is like the Ottawa Press Gallery. So we just one at a time.
You don't have the number for the jobs, but you do have a cost saving number. So you have to have made a calculation.
We have a conservative cost savings numbers based on the restructuring of parts of the system. You know, we're not in a position to give you that number as much as you might like it at this time. More than you bargained for, and you'll have more information as we go forward.
Standards of care across the province as part of this system. That's the outcomes that you're talking about, one of the outcomes you're talking about. Can you give me some examples of what that is, where we don't have common standards now, and where there will be common standards?
So I'll let people with an MD behind their names to give you that.
Sure. Well, the reality is that in our system currently, you know, that various organizations largely set their own standards of practice in many cases. And through the 12 clinical teams that Ian talked about, we'll be bringing those clinicians together across the province in areas like mental health and addiction, et cetera, to try to standardize. I mean, if you take something like radiology, for example, and the way they will do an MRI examination, and this gets a little technical, but standardizing the number of slices that you do for any particular kind of exam. There's no reason why in areas like that we shouldn't be consistent. And so in many of the clinical areas, we want to ensure that where it makes sense and where it's important that we ensure a consistent standard of practice. And we have built, as Ian was alluding to, a whole clinical governance model within shared health that actually has got the buy-in of the whole province. One of the fears about doing anything from a provincial perspective has been the fear that somehow Winnipeg will dictate to the rest of the system what services should be provided where and what the standards of care should be. So we've got a clinical governance model and a planning model which has actually been very well received mm-hmm. by rural and northern Manitoba and very well received by Winnipeg. So we think we've got the right approach. And there's many examples.
Can you give me some of those examples other than how you
run diagnostic systems? I mean, something that people could understand?
I think the standards range all the way from clinical guidelines and protocols around how to treat particular diagnoses or clinical presentations, all the way to how we're going to organize ourselves in terms of the actual clinical service delivery, you know, what are appropriate staffing ratios, et cetera, across the province. Those are the kind of things we want to be able to standardize as well. To the Choose Wisely recommendations, you know, we're sitting on Choose Wisely recommendations that say, for example, that if you've got low back pain, you shouldn't be just routinely ordering an MRI. Those kind of things that we're aware about clinically that just make sense to do in a certain way and that are more efficient and provide better care and avoid false positives. We've struggled to actually implement those things across the province. Now we've got a vehicle. Now we've got a vehicle to do that. Well, for some of those things that I've mentioned, like the MRI for low back pain, we've taken kind of an educational approach using initiatives like Choose Wisely. But what we've never had, Tom, is the actual ability as a health system to declare a particular standard of practice. So, for example, radiologists, just to use that example again, when somebody orders a diagnostic test, which the radiologists know is not really appropriate, you know, they're better off ordering this test instead of that test, they're reluctant to push back on the referring physicians at times because the referring physicians can get very grumpy with them and say, well, who are you to tell me what I can and cannot order? And in some cases, we've actually had those referring physicians making complaints to the College of Physicians and Surgeons. If we had, when we have clearly defined provincial standards that have been approved by the most senior clinicians in the system, which we now have a process and a mechanism to do that, the radiologists are quite happy pushing back against referring providers because they can stand behind a provincial guideline or protocol that has been approved by the senior leadership.
Is that subject to negotiations with doctors in Manitoba?
No.
Minister, you've talked before a little bit about rural health care, but I just want to know a lot of information here. There's a lot of people waiting on pins and needles to know if there's going to be hospital closures in rural Manitoba, if there's going to be jobs lost. What would you say to those people?
Well, I think I'd say to them that the system in rural Manitoba hasn't worked well for a long time. And I think if you live in rural Manitoba, you know that. And so not unlike the system in Winnipeg, where people understood there needed to be change, and we're looking forward to change. Everybody won't always agree with the change, but I think the people who live in rural Manitoba and being one of them would know that the rural Manitoba healthcare system hasn't worked for a long time, and so the changes that we're going to look to implement will better the system and better the outcomes. Demonstration of that, I think, really is the EMS system that we're now revamping to bring full-time paramedics, 60 new additional ones this year, more last year, so that, you know, we had situations where part-time and volunteer paramedics were passing the scene of an accident to go to their ambulance and then driving back to it. It wasn't a system that was working well. We wanted to work on EMS first to show that this is about building a better system, because it's costly to hire new full-time paramedics, but we're doing that. To have that as the backbone of the system, to demonstrate that it's about delivering better care. So the rural changes that are going to come are going to be focused on delivering better care. But people who live in rural Manitoba understand that there is a problem in the system now. Just as people understood in Winnipeg, there's a problem, but it's a different problem. In Winnipeg, there's a lot more concentration on when you get to the ER, how long are you going to have to wait? In rural Manitoba, the question is, if you get to the ER, is it going to be open? So it's a different dynamic in rural and Winnipeg. They both understand there's problems. They're just different problems. So I think the people in rural Manitoba know that the system wasn't working well, and they'll understand there needs to be change.
But there has been a pretty stretched out timeline here. I mean, this is taking a long time. A lot of people want to know. They want answers.
Well, I mean, listen, I've been criticized by the media for things going too fast, and now I may be criticized for things going too slow. So, I'm not driven by a timeline that is fast or slow. I'm driven by a timeline that speaks to evidence. And where we get evidence and it's time to act on that evidence, then we act on it. When we need to slow down, because, for example, the Wait Times Task Force tells us we should slow down to have the expansion at St. Boniface happen, well, we've done that. And so we react to the evidence. But sure, I have 20 people a day who tell me it's going too fast, and maybe 20 people now who are saying it's going too slow. But at the end of the day, we're gonna respond by evidence, Brock.
Yeah, I just want to provide some assurance that we are looking very carefully at that whole emergency department issue in rural Manitoba. The emergency task force did clearly articulate that we have too many emergency departments, small emergency departments, that in many cases aren't sustainable. What we've been doing in the interim is gathering a lot of very specific information about every emergency department in the province. What proportion of CTAS 1, the most critical patients, do they have? The task force report suggested that an emergency department should see at least 12 of those patients a year. How many CTAS 2 patients? The report suggested there should be at least 200 a year. Does that emergency department provide blood services? Are they capable of doing intubations? Can they insert central lines? What access do they have to diagnostic modalities? And as the minister said, our recommendations around which emergency departments are viable in the long term and which are not is not going to be based at all on cost savings. It will be based on whether that emergency department sees enough true emergency cases to make it safe to keep an E over the door, and for patients who are in a true emergency situation to know that if they go to that emergency department, they will actually receive emergency care. That's first and foremost. And second, in some of these departments, notwithstanding all their efforts, they've just simply been unable to recruit and retain providers. And so those are going to be the issues. And then it's not just a simple matter of saying this emergency department will remain open and this one will not. We have to pay attention to what's the primary care model that's going to be in those communities, particularly if they don't have an emergency department. How is the reorganization of the EMS system? Because that's what also patients are concerned about. How quickly is an ambulance going to come when I call the ambulance, as well as will the ambulance know which emergency department is open? We think we can do things provincially to provide support to the primary care providers to help them manage urgent and emergent situations. As you mentioned, Minister, the EMS staff can do a lot more now than they could before in terms of see and treat. All of that we're taking into consideration. And then, of course, we're also looking through this process at the population health. So it sounds simple, but all of that is being looked at. All of that will be considered and reflected in the recommendations that come to the minister. And there may be some recommendations in July that are very clear. You know, we have enough information to feel confident that these emergency departments need to transition to something else. But it's also possible that there'll be some parts of the province where, quite frankly, we need to kind of do more of the broader provincial clinical planning before we can be definitive in our recommendations. But we will have some recommendations to the minister in July.
One more question.
So we're getting savings. We're going to get savings. Administrative, fewer bargaining units, strategic cost alignments,
and a much reduced rate of growth in the healthcare spending.
Right, and we have an undefined number of people that may be laid off. We just don't know that.
But also people that regularly leave the system, right? So if we manage it properly, those. We have to take that into consideration.
Can you divide in amongst the amalgamations and consolidations and change of responsibility, some of the bricks and mortar changes? I remember food services. Remember they consolidated all the food services?
I remember a little bit about that. Yeah. Like, well, we provide a lot of information in terms today, and I think we've shown a lot of information in the past in terms of the consolidation. I recognize not every one of your questions, Sean or others, will be answered today, but we've committed to being as open and transparent in this process as we possibly can. You can look back and correct me, because maybe I'm wrong, but I think that we have been as transparent in this process as any government, you know, has been when it comes to changes in healthcare. We publicly released the Peachy report. We publicly released the Wait Times Task Force report. We publicly released the KPMG report. We publicly released Virgo, even two versions of it. And so we've been as transparent, I think, as we possibly can, as a government. This is probably more detail on the healthcare system than you received in the previous 15 years under the former government. You might say it's too much detail. Every one of your questions is going to be answered today. It won't be, but I think we've given you more information than you've seen in 15 years, and probably more information than you're seeing in any other province in Canada in terms of changes and reports that have been publicly released. And not everything in those reports, you know, politically are easy to release, but we've released them in the fullest way we possibly can. So there'll be more to come. I look forward to sharing more in the future. And thank you, because I know this is a weighty topic, and I appreciate you to being here and weighing in.
What is the private sector engagement strategy that in Workstream 6
a work stream Michelle.
There are many places, Richard, where the private sector could deliver services, and so that's now that we understand the bones of the transformation, to look at some of the all the shared services and the pieces that are delivered there, and see where there's ways that some of those functions could be delivered in a different way, and to engage with the private sector to understand what their perspective on the transformation is and opportunities that they see. And we haven't really spent time at this stage really looking at how the private sector could actually leverage this plan up. And so that strategy really is about taking the time now to take the transformation roadmap and discuss that with them and get exposure to them and reflect that into the subsequent waves of the plan.
But we're not going to be scared to do that. And the example of that was transitional care and the extended home care program, which has had tremendous success in reducing the number of people who are waiting in hospital for a personal care home. We got criticized significantly, not by you folks in the room, but by others, for having a private engagement in that plan. That plan worked. That was a recommendation of the Winnipeg Regional Health Authority. They asked me whether or not we should be engaging the private sector or doing that through the public sector. I said, do what's right for the system. It doesn't matter to me if it's public or private. I want what's best for the patients and what works. And so if the private sector can engage in a way that betters the system, then we're going to engage them, because ultimately, whether somebody is walking into a home or another care facility with a union card isn't as important to me as whether or not they're providing the service that they need. So that's going to be the philosophy going forward. I care about the service, and I'm not as married to who's providing the service. Thanks very much.